Jnananjana Salakaya Chakshurunmilitam Jena Tasmai Sri Gave Mancha Kalpatarubhyasya Kripasindubhyay Vacha Patitanam Pavanibhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayati Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namo Gaurat Vishnu Gurave Gaurachandraya Radhikaya Tadale Krishnaya Krishna Bhaktaya Padabhaktaya Tavaivasmi, Najivami Taya Vina, Tidhidhyayavadhi, Tangnai Maamcha. First of all, my koti-koti dandavat in the lotus feet of my spiritual master, Paramaradha, Om Vishnu Pada Sutta Sishma Bhakti Pragyan. And same in the lotus feet of my Shiksha Guru, Astotar Sishma Bhakti Bhakti Vedan Swami Nara. Today is fourth day. Anyway, by the mercy of Guru Gauranga, very peacefully, we have passed so many days. Even so many devotees, more than ever, are assembled here. Up till now, no complaint. So, yesterday in class, we discussed about Uttam Adhikari, Madhyam Adhikari, and Kanishta Adhikari. Uttam Adhikari, she is everywhere. What he is worshipping, in what mood, sent to Supreme Lord. He got pranam to all, thinking my Supreme Lord is everywhere. Even to blade of grasses and trees and creepers and everywhere. Very humble. And those who are Madhyam Adhikari, Prem Maitri Kripa Upeksha, they have love and affection to Krishna and Tadid and Adhineshu. Maitri with pure devotees, like friends, like junior friends, like senior friends, like some category, three kinds. And then to Balish Kripa, those who are ignorant, but not so much, or no but.
Not arrogant, but ignorant.
Arrogant, or taste, or nasty. Not nasty, not mayavadi. They do upeksha, neglect them. So these are Madhyam Adhikari. What?
Saying that who the Mahabhagavati, Uttam Adhikari, he will do upeksha to those who are envious.
Envious,
Krishna is always testing rasas. So he has nothing to do with our Bhadraji. Always Golok and Vrindavan. Always singing, dancing, playing on floats. In a rush always. So he does not know who is suffering nor suffering. Uttam Adhikari too, like Sukadeva Goswami, is naked quiet, going towards the whole world, always sinking in the ocean of thinking the sweet pastimes of Krishna. He has no idea that they are suffering or not. Only Madhyam Adhikari. If Uttam Adhikari, he will have to come in, Madhyam Adhikari, and then he will do. So Prema Maitri Kripa Apeksha for Madhyam Adhikari, and he comes among us, that Madhyam Adhikari. And he thinks they are suffering. So only by the mercy of Madhyam Adhikari, we can go towards Krishna Bhakti. And Kanishtha Adhikari, only archan of Krishna. He doesn't respect Tat Bhakti Su. He is devotee or other. Never. And then he has asked Maharaj Nemi, that how we can know he is Uttam Adhikari, Mahabhagavat, and he is doing. Grihitvapi indriyai arthan. Those who taking by his senses everything in this world, but if anything, happiness comes, nothing to please. And if so much suffering coming, not disturbed like that. What kind of suffering may come? What happiness it may come, but he is not disturbed, not too much happy. If he is so, then he is Uttam Bhagavat. Dehendriya prana mano dhyanjo. We know that janma mrityu, death and birth, bhook, pyaas, hunger and thirst, sram, kashta, labor, sram and kashta. That now I am very tired. Like this. Bhaya. Fear from others. He can take my money. He can take my wife. Old age is coming. I will die. So always bhaya. But he is not attached by anything. Nothing. He can be thirsty or without food so many days, no harm. Like Sukadeva Goswami. He never wants, never begs anything. By the wish of Krishna, anything is coming, he will take, otherwise nothing. Only air can take, water can take, and he will be satisfied. So, these are Mahabhagavata's symptoms. Nakam karma vijanam yasya chetasi sambhava. In their mind, in their heart, nothing comes, the desire of sense gratification never comes. No bees at all. No seed coming. Never any worldly desire comes in his heart. And always situating in Brahma, that is in Vasudeva Krishna. Oh, he is Mahabhagavata. Those who have no attachment to this body, that I am my, this is my body, I am body. And for other relatives, their father, mother, bandhu, bandhav, and others. He has no false ego. Oh, he is certainly Mahabhagavata. If whole world's wealth comes to him and goes, he has nothing to do. He will not be affected at all. We will be affected if some money will come and go. And always situated in Krishna Chintan, remembrance of sweet pastimes of our Krishna. Visrijat hridayam na jasya sakshat hari avaso abheto ap aghaughanasa. The name of Krishna, if anyone being bebas, what? Being bebas?
Helpless.
Bebas means that Ajamil, when Jamdut came and not knowing, and he told Narayana for his son. So if anyone here or chant this name, so his so many kinds of rashi, whose pap rashi, only one name of Krishna can destroy all these things. Thus Krishna, those who have binded in it their love and control Krishna, they are really Bhagavat Pradhana. These are symptoms. Then Nani asked, oh, I want to know what is Maya. And Tirupo, Maya is very, very difficult. How we can conquer that Maya? And then he told Maharaj, Najogendra, one of the Antariksha, he told, you should know that creation is done by Maya. What we see by these eyes, what we feel by our senses, everything is Maya. Especially, once Kamdev, Cupid, wanted to defeat Narada Rishi, but he could not. And then Kamdev, folding hands, prayed and returned back. So something came in his heart, ego. But Krishna cannot tolerate, he will do or pray. He will take out. So, he went to Brahma, his father, told, oh, you have told me, don't tell to Narayana. And then his guru, Narayana, went to Shankar. Oh, hearing this, Shankar also advised, don't tell to Narayana. But he went to Vaikuntha and he told, oh, by your mercy, I have conquered Kamdev. It is very difficult for Brahma or others. Krishna told that, oh, you are greatest bhakt. And then he wanted to operate. So in the meantime, when Narad left the Vaikuntha and came to world, this world, he saw a beautiful lady. Very, very beautiful. He has never seen a beautiful lady before. And his father has made Swayambar. What Swayambar? She will take garland and he will see who is beautiful, are fit for me, and then see. This is called Swayambar. He saw that. Oh, the lady is very, very beautiful. I have never seen. She is like Lakshmi. And then he went to his father and told, oh, I want to marry your daughter. Oh, I want to read upon the lines of hands, astrology. And he saw, really she is Lakshmi-like. And then he was so much attracted. And then his father told that you can come in Swayambar. And if she will give garland, you know, neck, oh, I will do marriage. Now Narada saw that I am like old. I am not so much. So he went to Narayana again and told, I have never begged you anything. Please be merciful. For one day, you should give your beautiful face form to me. And then Narayana told, Kalyanam Bhavatu. One day. For your
benefit, welfare.
Welfare, I will do everything. What can I not do for him? He thought that he has given. And he at once came to Swayambar. And where that lady was going to give mala, but not giving anyone. She was searching a very good, qualified person. Not used to go to his in front, that he is not looking, otherwise how he will not be attached. So here and there he, everywhere. But she never did get garland. In the meantime, Vishnu himself, Narayana, came in Garuda and that lady gave garland to that Narayana. And Narayana at once flew. Oh, he became very angry. There were two the associates of Shankar. They were laughing and joking. Oh, how beautiful you are. How beautiful you are. Please see your face in water, in glass. But he never thought and he was moving here and there. But when Narayana took Lakshmi with him, then he became angry. And he went to Narayana. I never begged you. Whole life I have done your mercy. And now you have neglected me. So, as I was weeping for, wife No one is controller you. No one can, but I will control you. And then he saw his face in water. Oh, monkey Hanuman. Yeah. And he became more angry. Oh, as I am weeping and searching from my wife, you should also be very worried for your wife and me. And then he told Abhishap to Shankar associate that you will be demon. So they become Raman Kumbhakaran. Oh, and what face you have given, that face will help you. So this Ram, oh, this is Maya. This is Maya. Even Narada liberated, but that Maya made dance to Narada. Also, you know, Mohini. Mohini. Shankar told to Krishna, I want to see your Mohini Roop, Mohini form. Again and again he requested. And then Krishna become Mohini Roop, half naked, taking flowers, jumping like dancing. And what became Shankar? He saw Mohini. And he ran after Mohini. He became naked. His Mrigachala box, his Damaru also. And Trishul also. And he began to run after. Parvati told him, what are you doing? But he, after that, by the request of Parvati, oh, Krishna again became in Narayana. Oh, this is Maya. In this world, we are not this body. Not body. But we think that we are body. Really, they are relatives. Son, daughter, father, mother, bandhu, bandhu. Not related to him. They are eternal servant of Krishna. But he thinks that they are mine. And for this he becomes also much worried. Oh, this is Maya. You know, at the time of Pralaya. Pralaya. Whole earth becomes water, and water becomes fire, fire becomes air, air becomes ether, and ether goes in Brahma, and Brahma also, he goes in the Karnabdha Sai Vishnu. Thus, whole world is finished. Oh, this is Maya. So Maya is very difficult to conquer. You should try to always remember and
meditate
Krishna, sweet pastime, then Maya will be very far away. Only remedy is this. If Brahma, Narada, Shankar,
Vishwamitra,
there can be enticed by this Maya, what to tell us? Be always. Waste time. Human body, human form, in this form only, we can have love and affection for Krishna. We can have sadhu sangha, otherwise not. Krishna Das.
hearing all these things, Devi Maharaj asked, indeed, to conquer Maya is very, very difficult. But my question is, those who have Atma Buddhi, that I am this body, and they have relation, they are attached to worldly bandhu bandho. How they can cross this Maya? Please tell me. And then Prabuddha began to tell Karmanyaramana. No? Why not bring it?
Only one book. 18.
Only
one book. There's only one copy of 11 Canto.
Only one.
Two.
Waiting for you, Buddha.
Karmanyaramana. Yes, yes, I'm telling to you. Don't be insulting. Here from here.
The Buddha is up to translation, 11th Canto, we'll all have a copy.
After you translate the 11th canto, then we will all have a copy. from a real sadhu.
We have translation. But purport, not copy.
I will try.
So this is text 18. Sri Prabhuda Uvacha Karmani Arabamanam Dukha Hatye Sukhaya Cha Pashyet Paka Viparyasam Mitunui Charinam Ninam. So the translation, Sri Prabhuda said, accepting the roles of male and female in human society, the conditioned souls unite in sexual relationships. Thus, they constantly make material endeavors to eliminate their unhappiness and unlimitedly increase their pleasure. But one should see that they inevitably achieve exactly the opposite result. In other words, their happiness inevitably vanishes, and as they grow older, their material discomfort increases.
What is the purpose?
So, this is very clear that when we are enamored by the opposite sex, and the illusion of enjoyment increases, then we create so many desires. It's as if the woman and the man, they both have a dream to enjoy. And then they come together and they try through many, many years to create that dream, that conception of pleasure. But it is only a dream. It's not a reality. And when the two, the male or the female, understands that this is not working out to my pleasure, then there's friction very often in Western the world anyway. But in Indian society, it's a little different because they understand duty in this respect. And this is very important, actually. In Indian society, the divorce rate is about 2 or 3%. In the Western world, it's about 80 or more. But they understand the aspect of duty. So even though if devotees take to this ashram and they perform their duty, as Srila Gurudev is always encouraging, then this ashram can be successful as Vaishnavas. But if we're Griha Medi, if we're trying to exploit each other for our own pleasure, then no success can be achieved. All failure will actually come, ultimately. And as I'm sure many of us realize,
Akinanjana Sadakaya Chaksurun Militan Ninatas, my Sikhurve Namaha. So, those who have experienced in Grihastha Ashram can speak. One marriage, two marriage, three marriage. But the material energy is very difficult to overcome, Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita. It's practically impossible. Only one who has surrendered to me can easily cross beyond it. So by the mercy of Guru, Vaishnavas, and Lord Krishna, the householder may get some strength, some principles, do bhajan, and gradually progress in their ashram to renunciation. But more often than not, what we see is that because of the contact with the opposite sex, opulence, money, especially if children are there, that there's so many plans for enjoyment. And this kind of phantasmagoria or dream can continue one's whole life. Because after children are grown, then one becomes grandpa, grandma, and also grandchildren are there, and they can continue to relive the fantasy of enjoyment in household life. So those who are fortunate enough to get the association of Srila Gurudev and other Vaishnavas will come to realize something of the dangers of material life and household life, especially Griha Medi Anda Kupam, engaging in illicit sex or too much sense gratification, keeping too much money, and hoarding things in this world for one's own desire, but will begin to gradually give up the results of one's labor and fruit and serve Hari Guru Vaishnavas by giving some money, by doing some seva, by coming into the association of Vaishnavas, hearing Hari Katha, by doing Guru Seva. And this way, gradually, through household ashram, one will become purified, and the disease in the heart of lust, and lust taking all forms, not just sexual gratification, but lust for position, fame, money, any opulence in this world will gradually diminish, and one will become more and more attached to hearing and chanting and devotional activities. Then one will enter vanaprastha ashram, sannyasa ashram, and become completely attached to the Lord and go back home, back to Godhead. Go.
Explain, same slow.
I'll just read the translation again. Accepting the roles of male and female in human society, the conditioned souls unite in sexual relationships. Thus, they constantly make material endeavors to eliminate their unhappiness and unlimitedly increase their pleasure. But one should see that they inevitably achieve exactly the opposite result. In other words, their happiness inevitably vanishes, and as they grow older, their material comfort increases. Discomfort increases. Om Agyanam Timirandasya Gyananjana Salakaya Chaksuranalitanyena Tasmai Sri Guru Namaha. So in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna makes two analogies that possibly explain this idea. He says in the third chapter, when Arjuna asks him, "What is it, O Lord, that makes people act even without their own volition? They're forced to act against their will in this world." And Krishna replied, "It is lust alone, Arjuna, which is just like fire, which burns just like fire, which is the all-devouring, sinful enemy of the world. Just as fire rages and screams out for fuel, and one may think, if I provide fuel, I'll satisfy the fire and it will diminish. But the more we try to satisfy the fire, the more the fire rages. So the more one tries to satisfy lusty desires, the more those desires increase." Our Srila Prabhupada quoted one Vaishnava poet who lamented, "I tried so hard to satisfy these senses, but they're never satisfied." Then someone may say to them, "Well, if they're not satisfied with your service, why don't you give up their service then?" So that Vaishnava poet said, "The problem is that although they're never satisfied with my service, they're not kind enough to relieve me from that service. This is chaos." Another analogy given by Sri Krishna in Bhagavad Gita is in the 15th chapter, where he compares this material world to a river, an upside-down banyan tree, where everything is upside down, being reflected in the river. The roots are up and the branches are down. Also, this tree reflected in the muddy river doesn't even look exactly like it looks in the reality. It's reflected in muddy river, so the fruits, the flowers, the leaves are all not very beautiful, they're distorted, and it's just muddy water. If anyone tries to pick a flower or fruit or leaf from that muddy water, he'll become frustrated. And if he tries to enjoy some food that's reflected in a mirror, and he goes to that mirror and goes for that food, he'll simply hit the glass. And the more he tries harder and harder, finally he breaks the glass and there's havoc and bloodshed. So the more we try to satisfy the senses, the more they create yearning and frustration and defeat. In the spiritual world, Krishna has a desire to understand the love of Srimati Radhika. He wants to understand his pastimes from her side, and so he becomes her in the form of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. That is, he accepts her mood. Pervertedly reflected in this world, in all loving relationships, we try to understand the mood of the beloved. What is he thinking? What is she thinking? Did that smile mean she likes me or that she has another lover? So the more we try to enter into that love, the more we try to put our mind in the sense gratification, the more and more we become bewildered. Krishna says also in the Bhagavad Gita that the mind engaged in desiring Krishna is satisfied, and that mind desiring sense gratification can never be satisfied. It's not that the non-fulfillment of the desire causes misery. It's the material desire and the turning away from Krishna that's miserable. Now my hand is facing the light and it's in the light. If it turns a little bit away from the light, it's in the darkness. And we know that in the darkness of night, there's so many scary objects that we imagine. So turning away from Krishna, Maya Haya Andhakar, and turning to the darkness of Maya in so-called loving affairs, then we simply are in fear and lamentation and illusion. Srila Prabhupada gives the example that if you try to see someone else in the darkness, even if they're standing right next to you, you can't see them. But when the sun comes up in the day, then you can see each other very easily and have a relationship with each other. Similarly, trying to relate to each other on the basis of the body is like seeing in the darkness. It's not seeing. But seeing through the medium of seeing Krishna in the other person's heart and Guru in the other person's heart and relating to them in that way, then we can actually see each other. In the once in a blue moon experience that I had in a van with Srila Gurudev from Badger to Oakland about 8 years ago, Gurudev was saying that only when we love Krishna can we actually have any affection for anyone in this material world. All affection in this material world is illusion. So I said, well, what about the affection of God brothers and God sisters? So he said, will one Atma marry another Atma? So then Nandagopa Prabhu was driving. So I said, well, what about Pundarik Prabhu, who was in the car, and Nandagopal? They're two God brothers. What about that affection? So Gurudev said, do you know who Nandagopal really is? Do you know him? No. Until we know who he really is, we cannot have real affection. So if we throw our rock, we're throwing rocks in the pool. If we all throw our rocks in the same spot, then the circles go round and round, bigger and bigger, till the edge of the pool or pond. But if we throw our rocks in different parts, then those circles overlap each other, and there's conflict of the circles. Similarly, if we all put our love in Krishna, then our love expands to everyone. And when we all put our love in ourself and our objects of sense gratification, then there's always conflict of interest and quarrel and fear and lamentation.
To be happy and to avoid all kinds of suffering, we have engaged our whole senses in that. Especially to remove suffering. And for this whole world sitting at a place, Sanjukta Rashtra. United Nations. They discuss what they are doing. They cannot do. More sufferings are coming. Old will, age will come. You will have to give up this body. So many problems. So, this is not method. Also, we are always engaged in making money. That money will help us. But really not. Nityarthi deyina vittena.
Om Jnana Mirandasya Jnanam Janashalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha. So the next text, Nityartidena Vittena Durlabhenatma Mrityuna Griha Patyapta Pashubhi Kapriti Sadhitaischalai. It's speaking about wealth. Wealth is a perpetual source of distress. It is most difficult to acquire, and it is virtual death for the soul. What satisfaction does one gain, actually, from his wealth? Similarly, how can one gain ultimate or permanent happiness from one's so-called home, children, relatives, and domestic animals, which are all maintained by one's hard-earned money? So here, Srila Gurudev has mentioned that wealth also, just like we have so many false hopes to enjoy in this world by connecting with another jiva and trying to establish happy family life, this is our hope, this is our dream. Similarly, we also approach wealth in the same way. We think that if I acquire so much money, so much wealth, then my happiness is going to increase. Why? because we think that by this money, oh, we can get the honey. This is what Srila Prabhupada actually told in his purport. Money, money, sweeter than honey. Brighter than sunshine. So this is the hope and dream of the conditioned soul, because he identifies that this money is the root cause of the happiness. Because by acquiring this money, this wealth, oh, then I can acquire all the necessary paraphernalia, all the necessary sense objects in this world. I can buy a nice big house. I can get a very beautiful car. I can have a big bank balance that I can draw from for all the problems and all the responsibilities, raising the children, sending them through school, and all of this. So there is this expectation that by acquiring so much wealth, then I'm going to be happy. But actually, as it is stated here in this verse, what happens is the opposite. Because the wealth itself is temporary. The wealth also is external to the soul. As Srimati Shamarani Didi described so graphically, that the soul cannot actually enjoy the objects of this material world. And no matter how much wealth one acquires, the soul will still remain dissatisfied. We see many, many examples. There are many current examples in modern history of personalities who acquired so much wealth and so much fame, so much glory, big celebrities, Marilyn Monroe's and so forth, but they could not find happiness by all their fame, by all their wealth. So the soul cannot be satisfied by any external objects of this world. And the point that is being made here is that the wealth itself is temporary, and therefore, in the end, we will be dissatisfied. So what to speak of the objects that can be bought and purchased by this wealth? But nevertheless, everyone is going on with this grand illusion, thinking that the more I work hard and the more that I try to acquire wealth, then I will be able to get more sense gratification and I will become happy. There's another series of verses in Srimad Bhagavatam, fifth canto, which are Spiritual Master Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, he used to quote quite often in his preaching, the teachings of Lord Rishabhdev to his 100 sons. So he used to quote one verse, Nunam pramattak kurukte vikarma yad indriya pritaya aprinoti. Tatsadamanye yata atmanoyam asannapi kleshada ashadeha. Nunam pramatta kurute vikarma. They are very pramatta, the conditioned souls. This is describing the nature of the conditioned souls in this world. That they think out of this madness of a desire to enjoy sense gratification, they perform so many vikarmas. Nunam pramatta kurute vikarma. Because of this illusion, this pramatta actually means madness or craziness. So the conditioned soul is in this illusion, this maya, as Gurudev described in the beginning of the class, that the whole material world is this maya, this strong illusion. So because of this pramatta, this craziness, yad indriya pritaya aprinoti, he thinks that simply by enjoying the senses, that this will bring satisfaction. But tatsaduman ye yata atmanoyam asannapi kleshada ashadeha. It only ends up bringing him more klesha. Klesha actually means sufferings. Because he's accepting this temporary material body, and by performing these vikarmas, vikarmas means prohibited activities, trying to gain sense gratification, going to any extremes to acquire this. And the result of that is that, again, he has to accept another material body. Just like Srila Gurudev told yesterday, that because of attachment in this world, like Bharat Maharaj, he was attached to a baby deer. But the attachment between male and female in this world is much stronger than that. So certainly at the time of death, if someone has cultivated this deep attachment within this life, then they will certainly be thinking at the time of death about the persons to whom they are attached. And the result is, male will be thinking of the female and become female, and female will be thinking of the male and become male in next life. And in this way, again, asanna piklesha da asa deha. Again, he has to accept the miseries of this material body by taking birth again in this world. So all of these teachings being given in the 11th canto here are teaching the method for coming out of this illusion by first of all recognizing that it is illusion. And if we don't recognize this, then again and again we will become snared by this false conception of life, that I am this body and everything belonging to me is actually mine. And by this identification, again, we have to accept another body. Hare Krishna.
Jigyasu se uttamam sabde parecha nishanatam brahmani upasa.
Om Gyana Timanandhasa Gyanandana Salakaya Chakshur Militam Dena Tasmai Sri Gurave Nama. So now, among Navayogendras, Prabuddha Maharaj is giving the conclusion. Tasmat Gurum Prabhadeta Jigyasustrayam Uttamam Shabdei Pari Chanishnatam Brahmani Upashamasrayam. We have heard how by relationships in this world we cannot be eternally happy. We have heard how by the accumulation of wealth and everything that that brings, we cannot be permanently happy. Prabuddha Maharaj also mentioned by performing sacrifices and going to Swarg, to the heavenly planets, one will eventually return here. So whichever path we take in life ends up with what? The repeated cycle of birth and death. No happiness or satisfaction, only endless frustration. Tasmat, therefore because there is no way to success, because there is no other way to happiness, tasmat, therefore, gurum prapadeta. One must submit oneself instead of to society, family members, and to one's senses and material desires, one must prapadeta, submit oneself where tasmat gurum prapadeta, at the lotus feet of Sadguru. Tasmat gurum prapadeta jigyasu sarayam uttamam. And there, at the lotus feet of Guru, one can inquire about Sreya. Sreya means auspiciousness, one's ultimate benefit. What is the ultimate benefit for the jiva? In this world, the ultimate benefit for the jiva is Bhagavad Rati, attachment for the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So therefore, such a person, such as ourselves, it is imperative that we take shelter at the lotus feet of Sadhguru and inquire, who am I? Who is God? How can I attain auspiciousness in my life? Therefore, the first line of this verse describes the qualification of Shishya, the disciple. The second line of the verse, Shabdei Paritanishtatam Brahmani Upashamasrayam, describes the qualifications of Sadguru, the bona fide spiritual master. Three qualifications have been given. One is Swarup Laksham. That means the intrinsic characteristic that makes a Vaishnava a guru. All Vaishnavas actually are gurus, they're real Vaishnava. What quality? That is the Swarup Laksham that makes guru guru, heavy, immovable, full of knowledge, more than that, full of prema. That is called Swarup Lakshan. Other two qualities are called Tatastha Lakshan. Tatastha Lakshan, they are extrinsic characteristics or marginal characteristics. They may be there in those who are not Guru, but they will certainly be there in a person who is Guru. Mm-hmm. So, what is the Swarup Lakshan and the Tathastha Lakshan? First, Tathastha Lakshan. Brahmani Upashamasrayam. Mm-hmm. He's detached from this world. The reason is because his heart is completely absorbed in Shri Krishna. So outwardly, we can see with the eyes how a person has no attachment in this world. Kanaka kamini pratishta bhagini chariyati saito vaishnava. Sayana sakta say shuddha bhakta. Those who have given up all attachment for the sex life, for collection of money, and for the accumulation of reputation, they're called Vaishnav. They've conquered the material energy. So first, the Tathastha Lakshan, Brahmani Upashamasrayam, he's detached from this world. Second Tathastha Lakshan is Shabde. Shabde Paritanishnatam Brahmani Upashamasrayam. The word Shabde, Srila Jiva Goswami Pad in his Bhakti Sandarbha has given a description. He said, Shabde Brahmani Veda Tat Pariyena Nishnatam. It means that the Guru is deeply versed in the meanings of Veda, Vedanta, Upanishad, Puran, Gita, Bhagavat, everything. All the Shastras. He's deeply versed in that. And because he's convinced of the conclusion of the Shastra, therefore he can convince any conditioned soul in this world who is surrendered at his lotus feet. The living entities in this world have so many doubts. But Sangsayatma Vinashyati. If someone has doubt in Krishna, in Krishna Naam, Krishna Dham, then they will lose everything. So how will the doubts be removed? So the second, that is the Tathastha Lakshan of Sri Guru, is in so fixed and in deep understanding of Shastra, and he can describe the philosophy of Veda, Vedanta, Upanishad in such a way that all the doubts in the hearts of the conditioned souls will be removed.
So, if you want to know how we can go across Maya, endless pain of birth and death, and to have Krishna prem, certainly you will have to go to Gurudev. And that Guru have this Sarupa Lakshan and Tathastha Lakshan, all qualities. He should know all the Shastra that he can remove the doubts of devotees. But this will not do when some realization of Krishna. This is main thing. Then he will tell Gurudev how he has attained Krishna Prem. He will describe himself. He's a story. Like Gop Kumar told his own history to his disciple. Otherwise. And Tathastha Lakshan also Upashamasrayam. He should not be attached to anyone in this world. No wife, no children, no wealth, no nothing.
What about disciples?
Disciple must be humble to take all these things. He should be of high class, cool family, humble. He should wake up in morning before Gurudev and sleep after his taking rest, always serving, obeying, not disobeying him. Thus, then, he had no attachment anywhere, but he is merciful. He is only attached to Krishna. Because he has no left anything for all these things. Only to Radha and Krishna. No time at all. Tatra Bhagavatam Dharman Sikshet Guru Atma Daivata Amaya Anubhritya Jastu Sedh Atma Dohari.
Om Agyana Timirandasya Agyanandina Salakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha. First of all, I offer my humble obeisances unto the lotus feet of my Gurudev, who has very mercifully invited me to attain the highest fulfillment. And I also offer my humble obeisances, Dhanabad Pranam, to all Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis who are present, all the learned and wonderful sannyasi senior Vaishnavas. And I ask them forgiveness for any offense I may have made. I don't speak so often, so I know that sometimes I may disturb or cause any difficulty. Please forgive me. First announcement. Nama Gopal Prabhu has requested me to announce. For Anukut, anyone who wants to cook or prepare anything, they can contact Nanda Gopal Prabhu, yourself, or Nila Chalidhi. There is boga available for those who want to cook. Wait. So I am not very qualified, I don't know how to cook. So Madhav Maharaj yesterday described the qualities of Kanishtha Vaishnava, that he knows how to cook, and I don't even know how to cook. So you can imagine my position. Now the sloka comes. Tatra Bhagavatam Dharman Siksat Guru Atma Daivata Amayaya Anuvritya Jais Tushyat Atman Atma Dohari. Not my mother language, my Sanskrit. Translation: accepting the bona fide spiritual master as one's life. Accepting the bona fide spiritual master as one's life and soul and the worshipable deity, the disciple should learn from him the process of pure devotional service. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari, the soul of all souls, is inclined to give himself to his pure devotees. Therefore, the disciple should learn from the spiritual master to serve the Lord without duplicity and in such a faithful and favorable way that the Supreme Lord, being satisfied, will offer himself to the faithful disciple. This is what most beautiful description of the behavior of a disciple. I pray that one day I may attain this qualification. So here it says, the spiritual master is teaching what? Sudha bhakti, only the process of pure bhakti. And the disciple who is faithful, who is sincere, he will benefit so much. What is that process? Anabilasita sunyam, jnana karmadi anavritam, anukulyena krishna anusilanam bhaktir uttama. When we have the great good fortune to receive the merciful glance and shelter of the bona fide spiritual master, many of us come with material attachments, as we have just heard the description, how difficult it is to give up the relationship with the opposite sex, and especially the desire for money. Life after life, we have been associating with these sense objects. So very, very difficult. Many times we experience how difficult that is. How to overcome that? Only by faithfully, sincerely taking shelter of the lotus feet of the spiritual master. What does that mean? That we have full faith. But the spiritual master, the bona fide spiritual master, is telling me it is for my ultimate benefit. I should follow that. Not only that, I should pray deep within my heart that my only attachment will be for the lotus feet, the service, the eternal association of that merciful personality who has saved me. Srila Gurudev just mentioned that the spiritual master is attached only to Krishna. To nothing else, nobody in this world. I once heard also, perhaps this is for the disciple most important, that attachment for nothing else except for Krishna means, first of all, do we know Krishna? First Krishna appears in front of the disciple, the aspiring disciple, in the form of Ashray Bhagavan, Gurudev. If we have attachment only for Guru and Krishna, Ashray Bhagavan, this will save us from all material calamities. And Gurudev mercifully instructs us in the process of pure bhakti only. This is the bona fide spiritual master. And most fortunate are those who are able to receive the association of that Sudha Vaishnava, who's completely immersed in the mood of the intimate followers in the line of Srila Rupa Goswami. What will he teach us? Amnaya prahat tatvam hari aha harim sarvasaktim rasabdim. But Gurudev teaches how the supreme, ultimate goal of us is Hari. Which Hari? Who is the son of Brajananandana? Who is the reservoir of all pleasure? Who is the source of all pure love and affection? Whatever affection we want in this world is a very dim reflection of that very affection which freely Krishna wants to give. And as Gurudev said, Krishna is absorbed. He has no time to worry for us. But mercifully, Gurudev coming to the level of Madhyama Adhikari, he distributes that mercy by his own association, by his instructions. We can attain attachment to always please that very spiritual master, to always assist him in a menial way, and to, under his guidance, serve the mission of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. There's many things in my heart which I want to share, and I have not, I don't know how much time.
Disciples should learn Parasparanu Kathanam Pavanam Bhagavat Jasa. Mithorati, mithatusti, nivritti, mitha atma. When we meet others, don't talk, so much suffering, my family has lost, my wife has divorced me, what to do, so many things. Don't discuss. Like Rupa Sanatana, when they used to meet together, what doing? Always talking about Krishna thing. Prasparanukat. So disciples should learn this thing. And Mitho Rati. He should remind him and he should remind him. Always the very sweet pastimes of Krishna. Always, always. So that Maya cannot enter. Other Maya will come. And how Krishna Prem be achieved? He should learn from his Gurudev. And then, Kvachit Rudanti Achyuta Chintaya. Kvachit Hasanti Nindanti Badanti Alaukaka. Nityanti Gayanta Manusila Mantajam. Bhavanta Tushnim Paramitta Nibritta. How Gurudev is always sinking in the ocean of Krishna. Sweet pastimes. Kvachit Rudanti. Very vilakshan sthiti. Vilakshan? Very vilakshan?
Extraordinary position.
Extraordinary. Like this. Oh, that kind of sadhu or guru. Oh, extraordinary character. Way they sometimes they begin to think, oh, up till now I have not taken darshan of Krishna and Radhika. What should I do? Where to go? Oh, crying bitterly. Here and there, where to go? Like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has told something like this. Kahan jaun? Rajendra Nandan. Bina phate mohi. So, this should be, we should learn all these things. And then they began to weep. And sometimes he will remember ki Krishna Supreme Lord, but even having so many opulence, he is hiding himself in the council of gopis. And then he becomes very happy and he begins to laugh loudly. And sometimes he feels that I have seen Krishna and Radhika. And then he becomes so happy, excessive. And then he begins to sing the glories of Krishna and Radhika. And he becomes to search Krishna and Radhika. Where they are? Where? Bhaktivinoda Thakura has written in his any song like that. Then he began. And then sometimes he becomes silent. So these are the things that a disciple, pure disciple, should learn from his guru. This human form is given by Krishna very mercifully because he is causeless merciful. So don't waste your time in this grihastha ashram. We have told, and Krishna will tell himself, this is a blind well. Blind well. You have tested this sense gratification in your past crores of lives. So don't come towards this. So, all these things we should learn from Gurudev and follow his instruction. Go, Prema.
Hare Krishna. So,
oh, what?
You said that the Guru is not attached to the disciple, he's only attached to Krishna.
Yes.
Another time you said that the Guru loves the disciple, but he's not attached. So what's the difference?
I'm lapsi. And he has so much affection, but not attached.
What is attached?
Because he is totally attached to Krishna. He has no his fraction to be attached anywhere else.
So what's the
but he will be merciful. And he will teach all these things, but not attached.
What's the difference between love and attachment then?
Oh, there is so much difference. Akash and Patar.
Like Patar has...
Attachment is... Lust means morcha.
Rust.
And love is pure.